whatever you're saving up for. A CD from Sandy Spring Bank lets you grow your savings at a guaranteed rate. Right now, earn interest at 5.50% APY on an 8-month CD special or 5.00% APY on a 14-month CD special. Learn more at sandyspringbank.com/CD specials. Minimum opening deposit to earn the annual percentage yield is $500 for the 8-month CD special and $2,500 for the 14-month CD special. Member FDIC.
An exploration hoax. I'm Jason Horton.
I'm Rebecca Lieb.
And this is Ghost Town.
Jonathan Swift's A Modest Proposal is arguably one of the most famous social and political satires in the English language. And one of the most famous lines within it is when Swift claims, quote, "a native of the land of Formosa," Formosa, now present-day Taiwan, "idiotically suggests the solution for poverty is feeding Irish babies to the upper classes." Remember that? From school, maybe? Well, 10 years after Swift penned A Modest Proposal, another celebrated author, Dr. Samuel Johnson, would befriend that same Formosian mentioned in A Modest Proposal, a blonde-haired, blue-eyed man with a vague French accent and bizarre rituals, a man who captured English audiences, claiming to be the first Asian man to visit Europe. His name was George Psalmanazar, and in the early 1700s, he was a superstar and a gigantic con man. In late 1702, Alexander Innes, an Anglican chaplain of a Scottish army unit stationed in the Netherlands, met a man he called a heathen, a handsome, blonde-haired, blue-eyed individual who spoke in a strange language and claimed to be from Formosa, again, modern-day Taiwan. Innes promptly converted the man to Christianity, christening him George Psalmanazar, after the Assyrian king Shalmaneser V, a nice, meaty Old Testament reference. In 1703, Innes, so fascinated by Psalmanazar's strange customs, which included a completely indecipherable calendar, eating raw meat spiced with cardamom, sleeping while sitting upright in a chair, and hours-long moon and sun rituals, left for London, taking his intriguing new convert with him. Innes planned to show Psalmanazar off to his fellow Anglican clergymen, maybe gain some clout in the most powerful church in Europe, or, hey, maybe both. When Innes and Psalmanazar touched down in London, news of the exotic foreigner with bizarre habits spread quickly, and Psalmanazar was pretty instantly famous. People loved him not only because he seemed palatably and inoffensively, quote, exotic, but also because his story appealed to the idea of religion reforming, quote, inferior people, and the English people's anti-Catholic sentiment of the time. So what was his story exactly? Well, according to Psalmanazar, he was just a normal Formosian Asian man abducted by malevolent Jesuits and taken to France, where he refused to become a Catholic. Then he met Innes and converted to Anglicanism. To English media outlets, Psalmanazar was a star, a poster child for the right kind of colonialism. His specific religious commitment, his master of the English language, with a vague French accent that nobody questioned, he became a favorite of the Bishop of London and other highly respectable members of English society, who begged to know more. And Psalmanazar gave the people what they wanted. In 1704, Psalmanazar published a book called An Historical and Geographical Description of Formosa, an Island Subject to the Emperor of Japan. The book was a detailed description of Formosian customs, with charts, travel reports, diagrams, and more. According to Psalmanazar, Formosa was a prosperous country with a capital city called Externetsa. The people of Formosa mostly ate snakes that they hunted with tree branches. Formosians walked around naked except for a gold or silver plate to cover their genitals. Husbands were polygamous and had a right to eat their wives should they cheat on them. If you were to be charged with murder on the island, you'd be executed by upside-down hanging and then shot full of arrows. Psalmanazar also claimed the Formosians had built a gigantic temple for their high priest they called Gnotoi Bonzo, who commanded them to annually sacrifice, quote, "the hearts of 18,000 young boys under the age of 9 years on the first day of the year." Then Psalmanazar explained the priests ate the boys' bodies. They used horses and camels for transport and lived underground in cute little circular houses. According to an Atlantic article by Kimbrew McLeod, quote, Psalmanazar sounded like an anthropology major tripping on peyote. I'm not going to say I disagree. Jason, I'm going to show you some illustrations Psalmanazar created, and I just want you to give your thoughts on them and perhaps some ideas on what kind of person drew them.
I'm going to go into this with an open mind.
Yes, go in with an open mind. You know a little bit about this person that constructed these drawings. But I just want to ask, like, does this person have a command of, like, a culture? It looks like if you asked a European man from the 1700s to draw anything that wasn't European, to me, it would be like this very ethnocentric, like no, none of the men are wearing shirts, for example, but they're still like smoking like long pipes. The women have like a daisy crown. It's just like,
they almost look like superheroes.
Yeah.
A lot of capes, a lot of
cape draperies and, you know, like the shrouds of, I don't know what a burger is. One of the titles is a burger. One is a country bumpkin. One is a virgin and one is a bride. Of course, two very different things, the virgin and the bride.
Don't ask me which one I am.
No,
you can guess though.
Are you a Carrie?
I'm at least two out of the three.
Okay, that's good. I'm going to keep guessing. I'm going to keep ruminating on it. But clearly this person has no fucking idea. And again, if you're someone in the 1700s in Europe, maybe you'd be like, oh, that makes sense. But it kind of looks like old drawings of like pilgrims from the early Americas. It's like this vague kind of ridiculous idea of what someone that is not like you would look like. This man's quote unquote culture. But then there's the Formosan language that Psalmanazar described and graphed in obsessive and convincing detail. The Formosan alphabet had 20 letters that were written from right to left, a detail Psalmanazar probably thought was true of all Asian languages. It sounded, quote, a little Hebrew, kind of Greek, and the rest nonsense. All in all, he created a language that sounded, generally to many people, very real. Here is his translation of a Christian prayer into Formosan. Forgive my pronunciation of this language. Amy pornio danchin ornio viki gnajorhe se lori ifoder se bagalin jorhi sai dominion apo chin ornio kechin body ayan Amy katsada nada kichion toi ant nada yi ke radonye ant emi sochin brokatsky ken sai vi bagalin ke veri ke barhanian chinaania sendabe amien. The language was so impressive that German grammarians included samples of Psalmanazar's Formosan alphabet in books about language well into the 19th century, even after, well, spoiler alert, his fakery had been exposed. But for now, it was the early 18th century and Psalmanazar's book and story were both riveting. Psalmanazar was invited to lecture on Formosan culture and language all over Europe, including a lecture before the Royal Society. Despite all of this praise, there were skeptics who questioned, well, how European Psalmanazar looked. Quote, my complexion indeed, which was very fair, Psalmanazar recalled, appeared an unanswerable objection against me. The Royal Society report on him noted that, quote, he looked like a young Dutchman. But he did have an answer. Psalmanazar told an elaborate story about how the upper classes of Formosa lived, quote, in cool shades or apartments underground, which kept their skin very light. Although some ethnic distinctions existed during this period, like the difference between Europeans and African people, more nuanced categories of race did not yet exist. According to, again, writer Kimbrew McLeod in his Atlantic piece about Psalmanazar, quote, quote, there was simply no conceptual framework in place to ask the question, aren't you Caucasian? Another giant dissenting force of Psalmanazar's were the English Jesuits who had actually been to Taiwan on missions. They said that Psalmanazar was, in essence, delusional. They agreed that they had never heard of this language or these customs or anything Psalmanazar detailed in his public appearances or in his very bad book. But probably because of anti-Jesuit prejudice, nobody believed the Jesuits calling bullshit on Psalmanazar's strange and intense story. But eventually, some very powerful factors would unravel Psalmanazar's Formosan origin story. Mainly, time, ego, and opium. A lot of opium. We'll get to it after the break.
Hi.
This episode is brought to you by Pete's. Few things start your day better than a good coffee. That's why Pete's hand roast their coffee from a specific selection of high-quality beans. And they don't just put those beans into anyone's hands. Pete's trains their roasters for 10,000 hours so they can master the roast that gives you the most. Pete's Coffee. Coffee for coffee people. Find Pete's online or at your local retailer.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to... Has anyone seen the bride and groom?
Sorry, sorry, we're here. We were getting lucky in the limo and we lost track of time.
No, Lucky Land Casino, with cash prizes that add up quicker than a guest registry.
In that case, I pronounce you lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Daily bonuses are waiting. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Hello, how are you doing?
Hello, hello.
How's it going?
How's it going over there?
What's going on over there?
Oh, way out yonder?
I'm from a land far away you've never been to.
Oh, I see, I see. Tell me everything.
I'm here to thank the good people of Ghost Town for supporting, spreading the good word. We appreciate you from where I come from, the east side of Los Angeles.
Wow. What's your language like, your culture?
I'm a burger.
You're a burger.
And a little bit of a virgin.
Oh, okay. Now we know. Now we know.
What we put high upon a pedestal, where I'm from, are governments.
That's right.
And
that's
your correct. Ghost town government is second to none.
That's true.
Especially the mayors.
I mean, they're great.
I've heard a lot about the, I guess would be sorceress?
Hmm.
Does Ghost town government have a sorceress?
We do now. We do now.
Known as, and this is a mysterious name, Emma Hopkins.
Hello.
You also have a town blacksmith. I'm jumping around as far as the stations here, but they're all equally cool.
Yeah, and important.
With, again, very mysterious name, Ashley Mattson.
Hello.
And the town jester. But everyone loves the jester. Uh-huh. Everyone loves comedians.
That's true.
That's something we know. Through time and space.
Through
everyone
and
loves
space. Highest paid, most respected.
We love them. That'd be Kelly Meehan.
Hello.
And we have the town doctor. Just prescribing any old bottle of what?
He makes house calls.
Makes house calls, has a little bag.
He doesn't even have an office. He just comes on over.
That'd be Dr. Kat Jozell.
Hello.
Then we have the town crier.
What did they do? What is that?
Always crying. Crying about this, crying about that, but gets everybody's attention.
Oh, okay.
Everyone heeds the word of the town crier. And that would be Matthew Clement Laurie.
Hello.
And then we have the town bad person. Not really a criminal, but not a criminal.
I mean, it's like they abide by laws, but they have a bad attitude about it.
They kind of like they lean on things with one foot up.
Oh, nice.
Maybe smoking some whatever they're smoking.
Oh, with like a hat?
Yeah, like a hat pulled down in an alley.
All right,
in the
that's
little,
scary.
The narrow alleyways.
That's scary.
That'd be Casey Weber.
Hello.
And this town has a governor. This governor allows all of this to happen. Mm-hmm. Everything, it's a chess game. Everything's moving according to the governor's plan.
Mm-hmm.
Has almost a godlike reverie.
Almost.
No one knows. The town crier's like, I don't know about that. And the governor's like, I do know about that. And the town crier's like, okay.
Okay.
That would be our governor.
Avian
Noble. If you want no ads, no chit-chat, bonus episodes, just the good stuff, 7 days free. If you want to check in, check out, who cares, or support us a little bit more, we appreciate. Head on over to patreon.com/ghosttownpod.
Mm-mm-mm.
You want to get more back into burgers and virgins?
Let's do it. Let's get back. It's 1705, and everyone is still fascinated by Psalmanazar's story of being a Formosan and his book, An Historical and Geographical Description of Formosa, an Island Subject to the Emperor of Japan. Now, it's A-N, historical, starting with an H, so it's not grammatically correct. Maybe it was at one point. That's neither here nor there. Innes eventually went to Portugal as a chaplain general to the British forces. And again, he was also doing well at first. But by then, he had a pretty heavy opium addiction and had spent all the money he'd made in several misguided business ventures, including a failed effort to sell decorated fans he claimed to have imported from Formosa. Psalmanazar, also a zealous user of opium, made more and more out-there claims and became less and less credible as time went on. Also, knowledge of Formosa from other sources was brought to light. At this point, people were actually traveling there, and the Jesuits who had been there before were being taken much more seriously. The world, due to exploration by European colonizers, was getting smaller. Widespread publication of books was making corroboration of information much, much easier. Generally, London society was getting tired of what was called the Formosan craze. And as they should, for the reasons that I just mentioned. Of course, none of this bode well for Psalmanazar, and he saw the writing on the wall. In 1706, Psalmanazar and his story had curdled, and he was widely considered a giant national joke, as evidenced by an April Fool's-themed satire published in London's Spectator magazine. The March 16, 1711 issue announced, quote, "On the 1st of April will be performed at the Playhouse in the Haymarket an opera called De the Cruelty of Atreus. The scene wherein Thyestes eats his own children is to be performed by the famous Mr. Psalmanazar, lately arrived from Formosa, the whole supper being set to kettle drums." Psalmanazar had had enough of the humiliation and finally confessed, first to friends and then publicly. He said the, quote, "facts" contained in his book were a mishmash of travel reports, his vague knowledge and misinterpretation of Japanese and Chinese ideologies, and accounts of Aztec and Incan civilizations. In the years after he confessed, I would say came clean, but that doesn't quite feel right due to all the opium. Psalmanazar actually did a lot, despite, again, being a huge liar and not being taken seriously. At that point, he was a fraud and a full-on opium addict. But he worked as a clerk in an army regiment until the clergyman there sponsored him to go to school for theology. There, he learned Hebrew, co-authored a book, and contributed to a number of historical manuscripts, one of which was a compilation called A Complete System of Geography, writing about the real conditions in Formosa. In it, Psalmanazar pointedly criticized the hoax he himself perpetuated and sustained himself by writing 12 hours each day on a strict diet of 12 drops of opium mixed with a pint of punch. During this time, Psalmanazar also cultivated an unlikely friendship with the young writer and critic Samuel Johnson, who founded the Oxford Dictionary. Johnson recalled that Psalmanazar had been well known in his neighborhood as an eccentric but saintly figure, quote, "whereof he was so well known and esteemed that scarce any person, even children, passed him without showing him signs of respect." That's a shift. Psalmanazar also interacted with a number of other important English literary figures at this time, including, as mentioned in the beginning of this episode, Jonathan Swift. In 1753, Psalmanazar published his own book of theological essays, and at that point decided to turn his life around. I'm not sure why, but I can't imagine it was an easy life at this point. By 1762, he was a reformed, drug-free, religious man, and published his last will and testament, called, pretty bluntly, "The Last Will and Testament of Me, a Poor, Sinful, and Worthless Creature, commonly known by the assumed name of George Psalmanazar." In it, he directed that his body should be committed to the common burying ground in the humblest and cheapest manner, and declared that his History of Formosa book, that bestseller from 1704, was, quote, "a base and shameful imposture, a fraud on the public." On May 3, 1764, George Psalmanazar died, leaving behind a bizarre autobiography called Memoirs, commonly known by the name of George Psalmanazar, a reputed native of Formosa, which was published in 1764. In it, he admitted some actual truths about his life, or at least, people agree now that they were mostly true, but pretty spun in a classic Psalmanazar fashion. His father, he wrote, quote, "was of an ancient but decayed family, and left his mother and him to fend for themselves." Psalmanazar was taught by Franciscans at a free school, by Jesuits at a college, and finally by Dominicans at an unspecified university. In all of these educational institutions, he claimed to have been celebrated by his teachers for what he flagged as, quote, "my uncommon genius for languages," calling himself a child prodigy who was fluent in Latin at age 7. At 14, he became a professional tutor, and at 15, he became disenchanted with academia and was forced to leave for not succumbing to the sexual advances of a mother of one of his students. And then he was off traveling, setting up his elaborate plan to fool his fellow Europeans. As the years went by, others pieced together Psalmanazar's actual story, but again, it's hard to know for sure. Many believe he was born in southern France, some guess Languedoc or Provence, sometime between 1679 and 1684. To leave France, Psalmanazar first pretended to be an Irish pilgrim on his way to Rome. After learning English, forging a passport, and stealing a pilgrim's cloak and staff from the reliquary of a local church, he set off. But the locals knew Ireland very well, and he fooled nobody with his bad, corny disguise. Deciding that a more exotic identity was needed, Psalmanazar found inspiration in Jesuit missionary reports. Yes, the very ones who called him out when he came back to London, about East Asia, and decided to impersonate a Japanese convert, then a Taiwanese one, with, as his disguise evolved, lots of strange, made-up customs. Having never reached Rome, Psalmanazar trucked through Germany in 1700, 1701, and 1702, and appeared in the Netherlands, where he met Innes. And his fake identity really calcified. I want to note again that even into the 1900s, German grammarians included samples of Psalmanazar's Formosan alphabet in books about language. So entrenched was this guy's hold on European culture. And the craziest part, for all his writings, teachings, and admissions, his fame even, the birth name of George Psalmanazar, along with the motive to his whole strange Taiwanese hoax, is still and will likely always be unknown.
Gee, honey, those new shoes look great on you.
And look, they show off my new toenails, too.
New toenails? What happened to the old ones?
Well, they're not really new, just clear and healthy looking. Remember how embarrassed I was? They were so discolored, really awful looking.
Well, they sure look clear now. I wish I could wear sandals again. My toenails are a disaster. Look, this one looks white and that one's thick and yellow.
Here's my secret. Non-X Nail Gel. It clears out yellowing keratin debris, the cause of nail discoloration.
So that's it. I've got ugly keratin debris buildup under my nails.
And Non-X Nail Gel gets rid of it. You'll need to use it daily, but clear nails are worth it.
You bet. When we go to the beach next summer, my toenails are going to look just as good as yours do.
Thanks to Non-X Nail Gel.
Non-X Nail Gel for clear, healthy-looking nails. Now at Walmart, Walgreens, Rite Aid, CVS, and other fine pharmacies. In the foot care section.
Lucky Land Casino, asking people, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
Lucky? In line at the deli, I guess?
Aha, in my dentist's office. More than once, actually.
Do I have to say?
Yes, you do.
In the car, before my kids' PTA meeting.
Really?
Yes.
Excuse me, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
I never win and tell.
Well, there you have it. You can get lucky anywhere, playing at LuckyLandSlots.com. Play for free right now. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
From iHeart Podcasts, Supreme, The Battle for Roe, tells the story of the unlikely champions behind the landmark case Roe v. Wade. Starring Maya Hawke as 26-year-old lead attorney Sarah Weddington.
We're challenging the Texas abortion laws in federal court.
And Academy Award nominee William H. Macy as Supreme Court Justice Harry Blackmun.
Time is not the most important factor. Getting it right is.
Listen to the podcast Supreme, The Battle for Roe on the iHeart Radio app or wherever you get your podcasts.